I'm Mark Kermode. I'm here with Bill Forsyth, the writer and director of That Sinking Feeling. Bill, we wanted to start the commentary track at the beginning of the film because, tell me about this title sequence.
Well, this is the funniest thing. That's the title disappearing off
sinking.
The screen there, and we actually got a laugh. The title scene, the actual card got a laugh. And I remember we filmed it on Mick Coulter, the cameraman's front living room wall. We just got the credit of the black cards back, and we stuck the camera in front of it, and it was Mick's idea to do this little tilt shot and
title sinks.
Sinks,
yeah.
And of course I thought you had to tilt it up. He said no, you know, anyway we worked it out. And when I screened the film at the Edinburgh Festival, Colin Young, the director of the National Film School, he was in the front row. I always used to put Colin in the front rows of screenings because he had this wonderful laugh, and he started laughing, and then the title card, and I thought, this filmmaking is a breeze, you know. You just I'm not going to look back from here. So that was my first screen laugh on the credit.
And tell us about that disclaimer. This is set in a fictitious town of Glasgow, which bears no relation at all to the real town of Glasgow.
Oh, that was just a little conceit there, really, you know. But I wanted to get the idea that this was a fairy story. It wasn't a Ken Loach movie, you know. This was fantasy, and it was a fantasy that these people in the film, it's almost their imagining of or their dream. The way that I thought of the film was this character Ronnie, the whole film is a kind of bad dream that Ronnie has. Yeah, that was it. And funnily enough, this is the very first scene we thought, and this was.
You did start with the first scene, which is unusual because you rarely shoot in sequence.
This was the first feature film I made, and it's also the first scene that I directed. And in those days, I thought that I'd been making documentaries for 10 years, but
yeah.
I vaguely thought that you kind of started in the first scene and just shot your way through the film. But within half a day, you know, Paddy, the production manager, she put me straight. You know, she said, "No, you're going somewhere else to shoot something else." And I thought filmmaking was a breeze with this one because in the script I had described the drizzle, the fine Glasgow drizzle falling, you know, so we woke up this first day of the shoot and there's the drizzle and it's perfect, you know. But then of course 2 hours later it's still drizzling, the actor's sodden, you know, his little jacket's sodden, it's showing underneath his elbows and things. And I'm saying, well, kind of rain can go off now, you know, but it just rained for the next 3 weeks, typically. So filmmaking, during this day, filmmaking get harder and harder and harder. So by lunchtime we were about 2 hours behind schedule, and by tea time we were half a day behind schedule.
So tell us a little bit about the origins of how this came about, because you had actually written a version of Gregory's Girl before Sinking Feeling got made. So
that's right.
Give us the story.
The whole thing was I'd written Gregory's Girl and I tried to financial it in a kind of practical way, in a proper way through the BFI Film Production Fund. But they put me through the ringer for a year and a half making up their mind, and then they turned it down. They said it was too commercial.
So I just love the idea that you got turned down because it was, you know, people might like that.
I know, yeah. So, but that was the 70s. That was this. We were a different ethos.
So you set out to make something that was less commercial.
Well, I had all these young people from the Glasgow Youth Theatre, and I had hyped them up to go out and make a film with me. And this was a way of just really juicing all that energy. And it was also a way for me to get a film made because I had, you know, built up the energy too and needed to. I was a kind of desperado at this stage because Charlie Gormley and I had folded our little filmmaking company. And it was do or die for me, really, this film.
Yeah.
So that's what we did. And the rage stopped. But it was a terrific experience for me because I hadn't directed actors before. None of the people in the film had acted in a film before, so we were all just on this, you know, roller coaster together.
So tell me about the youth theatre and your connection with them.
Well, as a kind of 30-year-old documentary film sponsored filmmaker, I hadn't ever worked with actors, and you know, we were heading, this was in the kind of mid 70s, but we were heading to a point where we obviously wanted to make feature films. And so I figured that the best way to do that would be to kind of try and concoct a film with young people in it, because they would be cheaper and they would be easier to handle. You know, they wouldn't know what to expect of a director or whatever.
What to demand.
Yes, and we could learn together. So I went along to the Glasgow Youth Theatre, which was it wasn't a kind of posh organisation. It was an ad hoc little group that a guy called John Baraldi had set up in one of the community centres. And it was just more or less people from around the area, the east end of Glasgow. One or two people found out about people like Gordy Sinclair. They travelled a little bit because they heard about it and wanted to be part of it. But I just used to turn up there and sit in the back. I was mortally shy at that time, at that point in my life. And I found it very difficult even to talk to the kids. I would just go there and sit up in the back and watch John Baroldi go through the motions with them, rehearsing plays and whatever. They used to do a summer tour around Scotland. And eventually, after a great number of weeks, the kids, the young people themselves said, look, who is that guy that hangs about? I used to turn up my bicycle, you know, chain it to the fence and things. And John kept saying to me, John Baroldi kept saying, look, you've got to talk to them, you know, you have to really save it. And this was building up into a major thing in my life, that I'm going to have to talk to these kids. And finally, I did pluck up the courage. And got to know them and told them about the ideas. And, you know, we started to... In a funny way, I was very pleased to be able to make this film, because this film, Gregory's Girl, was a piece of fluff. It was set in a new town. It was all about romance and young privileged people at secondary school and all this stuff. This was more down and dirty. This was where we kind of were all living, because in the 70s, the late 70s in Glasgow, we've been through a kind of economic kind of low point recently, but it was very much like that then.
Yeah.
Youth unemployment was at a huge level in Glasgow. Unemployment was, general unemployment was the same. You know, the heavy industries were running down. The city was being torn apart in an attempt to rebuild it. So it was quite a period.
Yeah.
And the film, although it's a comedy and it's about a kind of heist, it's a kind of heist movie. There's a little bit of realness in it for all of the people that were involved in it. You know. Yeah, this scene they're talking about suicide. Actually, they're talking about best ways to kill yourself.
And so, it went from, you hadn't, you weren't an established filmmaker, but you somehow managed to get 16mm cameras and, you know, to put it to yourself. How did that happen? Because this, we should point out that this was recorded in the Guinness Book of Records as the cheapest theatrically released feature film when adjusted for inflation.
Exactly.
Ever.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Ever, yes, in those days, in the 80s, in the early 80s. Yeah, well, as I say, we had, I was running a little documentary company then called Tree Films. And
what sort of things are you documentaries about?
Sponsored films, really. Documentaries, actually, £2,000 a term for what we did. Sponsored films, we made films for the Highland Board, we made films about bricks, we made films about fishing boats, about trees, these kind of things. But they're all sponsored. The guys would pay. They were just glorified ads, you know, 15-minute ads, really. Yeah. But dressed up to look like documentaries. This was Glasgow. This was Glasgow in the 70s. That car was there.
Oh, that's right. You said that's not dressed. That actually was.
I was just driving home one night, and this I wrote this scene for. It was going to be set in a kind of park near where they stayed. And I was driving home one night and up Mary Hall Road, and this thing was there. And I thought, well, we'll shoot it there. And of course, the next day I didn't know whether it was going to be there or not. But fortunately, it still was. So that was the way that we made that film. We were just shooting from the hip all around Glasgow. And you can imagine the chaos of it, because we had a cast of maybe about 15, 20 young people. They ran the gamut from, some of them were still at school, some of them were unemployed, some of them had apprenticeships, some of them were starting college. So the idea of corralling all these young people at that stage in their life and disciplining them into being here so that we can shoot this scene or there and shoot that scene. It was, the whole thing was just a kind of logistical exercise, you know?
Yeah.
It's amazing that a film came out of it, because it was, we were just chasing our tails, and we had one minibus, and it was just driving around the city endlessly, picking up kids and dropping them off and picking up hamburgers to feed the crew. It was quite an experience.
But I mean, obviously, because you've been doing the documentaries, or as you said, the kind of commercial films beforehand, you know, you understand the grammar of cinema, and you understand the practical logistics of it. I think what's surprising is how good Sinking Feeling looks. I mean, as a piece of cinema, it's a good looking film.
It is. It's remarkable. Mick Coulter, cameraman, he was a young cameraman that we had used in our little sponsored movies, so. I was determined not to bring people in, because all these people were working for me for nothing, the whole crew. I had to go around everyone and ask them if they would give me some of their time, and we reached this agreement that they gave me 3 weeks, and it was quite a critical thing because that was 3 weeks in which they weren't going to earn anything, apart from they were also donating their equipment, things like that. And these are people who normally would work for the BBC and hire themselves out with their equipment and do this and that. And this was also the period, there was a general election going on here, so Maggie Thatcher was just about to be elected Prime Minister for the first time. So there was lots of work around. So I was getting that slight tension of, you know, having to use these people to the utmost because they were donating to them very precious time. You know?
That scene that we just saw, it's you in silent comedy, isn't it? It's referring back to the old generation, the whole thing about having the little meal with he's got the little cloth and it's the Chaplin-esque business
thing. And I remember on the soundtrack there's a nice little click of his plates when he walks away.
But you have got a great focus. Okay, so this is the point at which the sinking feeling.
Yeah. Once again, the local company, he does make Coulter car. Yeah. There it is again. That Volvo turns up everywhere.
This is the slightly lime green one that also turns up in Gregory's films. There's a cameo by Nick Coulter's car in every film.
We use it to block shots all over Scotland. And the whole thing, it was fairly organic, to use that horrible word, because the local business closest to the youth theatre, in which I employed quite a lot of people around the area, was Thomas Graham's Plumber's Warehouse.
Yeah.
So it was a local business. So it wasn't. It was only a stretch, and not a huge stretch of the imagination to the idea that you could steal things from there. So there was quite a lot of that around as well. But it, in a funny way, it became a kind of community undertaking as well, because we roped in a lot of, not so much money, but, goods in kind from local companies, the greengrocer and whatever. And also Thomas Graham allowed us to shoot in the heist scene in their factory. So we'll get to that when we find it. Look at that 70s decor.
Yeah, and
incredible.
That, and again, that's not a dress set, is it? That's just as you find it decor.
Funnily enough, we shot that in my office, and that was a little just a wall that we built because we.
Oh right, so that is a set.
But it's just wallpaper, probably out of Woolworths or something. Yeah.
It's the strange piece of art on the wall behind it, Bill.
God knows, I know that's unbelievable.
It's just horrendous.
We are sitting on a gold mine, or should I say, a steel mine, a stainless steel mine. Look, what's this area famous for? What's it well known for? Drunks.
Muggers.
Multiple social deprivation.
That's my favourite joke in the film.
Multiple social deprivation.
So how did the script come about? So, I mean, the inclination would be to think that it came out of workshopping and...
I had this thing at the time. We certainly workshop things, but I always really had to kind of insist on writing things, because in the theatre that they were doing, there's so much improv and all that. And in the theatre, it's okay. You can get a little chaotic and a little wild. But I had my little kind of plodding filmmaker's cap on, and I knew that you had to have the discipline. You had to know. If you turned up in a location, you had to know what you wanted to go away with. I don't want to go away with something. I would have to work out what I got. So I always insisted on whatever we workshopped, that it was written up and there was a script. There was a page or two that could be nailed, and that's the way it came about. But it was, as I say, the whole idea was just based on things that could conceivably be happening and the lives that they were living,
And this thing about, you had to do the whole thing in 3 weeks because that's how long you had everyone for.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Considering that you'd planned Gregory's Girl, and presumably you would have planned that as a bigger budget endeavour.
Yeah.
So the whole feeling of doing this was very guerrilla, very stripped down, do everything as economically as possible.
But the strange thing was that I didn't feel the lack of money, because if I looked around, there were 10 or 15 people around me, and they were all pros, and they were all doing what they should do. And somebody would turn up, at lunchtime and give us a drink and a couple of hamburgers. So everything was there, And it goes down to the effort of people like Paddy Higson, who was producing it, but she was also kind of cooking the hamburgers and things and driving around town picking up all these kids endlessly. But it was very, very exciting, because at the end of the day, it didn't feel like we didn't feel like we were up against it, we just felt we were making a film, you know, and it felt the most natural thing to do. And the whole filmmaking world opened up. I mean, we invented cinema, see? We invented in this shot, we invented the staggered zoom, and we put it to music. Just to get the scale of the building, there are two or three zooms that stop there, you know. We were inventing it. We invented the tracking shot. We had some big old kind of frames with the pram wheels on them, so we had a tracking vehicle. You know, it was just like it was a great feeling.
So you were talking about the, you know, you didn't feel.
I stole this from Alan Rennie, by the way.
What that pan?
No, the little guy, in Providence. Remember, he had a guy. He had a runner. He had a footballer.
Okay.
Running through.
But this is a recurrent thing for you, isn't it? I stole that from a French film. Is that your steals are all from either silent slapstick comedy or from French cinema?
It seems to be, yeah.
And Jaws.
Yeah.
Which of course you stole.
I'll decline. Say that in French.
So you were talking about it was done on a very, very tight budget, although you didn't feel the lack of money. But you did go to some people for sponsorship. Some came on board, others didn't.
Yeah, we went down. We ran the gamut. I think the biggest contribution would be in the hundreds, maybe £200 or £300 we got from one or two organisations. Shell Oil gave us £50. One of the trade unions, I think you remember this, we got a cheque for, I think, £1, a postal order, it was like £1.58 or something.
And many of those came on board because you said it was the youth theatre, because it had a sort of social...
Totally. I was playing that card to the hilt. You know, this summer we are making a film with the young people of the East End of Glasgow. You know, that was the stick, yeah, definitely. And we scratched together enough money to, say, buy the food and get the stock processed.
It's one of the things that was weird when we were looking through the receipts of the film, and it would be something like £1.50 for electricity and, you know, 60p for sandwiches and crisps. And then there was a random £3 for meat. At one point you just bought meat. It was like you were running a zoo.
Probably just, you know, you can imagine, you know, 16 hungry teenagers in Glasgow who've been dragged out of their homes or their schools and put into these funny costumes and told to act, and you got to feed them something.
So now, tell us about him, because he's a natural.
Rab, he has a natural. He's still in the theatre. He works in the theatre still in Scotland, and
of course worked with you again.
I'm just thinking about Rab in this film. I think he's my alter ego in this film, because he's the guy. He's supposed to be the boss, and he's supposed to be improvising this whole robbery and putting this whole team together. But he's the most heartless. Once again, everybody else seems to know better than he does what to do. And I think he was my alter ego, because I felt very much that way as well. I felt like I was hanging on to the coattails of this whole production that I put together, and learning every day.
And how did you, because you said you were fledgling at that point, how did you direct your actors? I mean, were you very standoffy,
No, I talked to them. I talked to them a lot. And I remember Rab, because I talked to him too much, because I remember Rab saying to me one day, and it did work because they came good, but I remember Rab saying to me one day when I was in full flow talking about the scene, and he said, I don't know what you're saying, but I know what you mean. So I said, well, that's fine.
This is a classic Bill Forsyth scene. Just the absurdity of putting them in the wheelie punt.
Uh-huh. Well, they say they have to get away. They need a secret conversation. So, and a spy.
Yeah, but you put them in the wheelie punt.
Well, I didn't have a kind of a launch on the Thames, you know. In a spy movie, they would be out in the Thames, or they'd be out in the golf course or something.
But you do like that, the kind of the absurdist detail, the kind of.
Yes.
The strange tableau.
Yes, and almost it's almost in quotation as well, because it's always quoting a kind of standard film scene, or it is mostly, because it's just like you're letting people know this is this scene where this happens, you know. Yeah. But you can take it to any length that you want.
So practically, how are you doing this? Were you on another boat?
No, well, this is the tricks you learn, because I thought that. I said to Mick Coulter, I said, how are we going to get the crew in the other boat? He said, you don't do that. We all stand on the pier, on the little wooden bit, And they're out there, and we just walk them back and forward as if they're out in the middle, and you don't see any land round about them. Of course, these scenes, they were really out there,
yeah.
And we were feeding the swans. But the dialogue scene, they were just alongside the little jetty.
And this is you learning the language of cinema?
That's it.
Or, as you said before, inventing the language
of
cinema.
Yeah, that's where it was. And it was all new to me, because I thought we'd need a barge or something. And I was never convinced that these tricks would work. I would say to him, like, no, that's not going to look... You know, he said, well, look, they've been doing it for 80 years.
So the key to making this work, basically, was that, you know, that your own inexperience was matched by the fact that you were surrounded by a crew who did know what they were doing.
Well, the funny thing is, the crew had as little experience in documentary... in narrative film as I had. But technically, they were a lot more adept because they were filming every day. This is the thing. I mean, a cameraman is obviously more experienced than a director, because he's out there and he's keep every single day.
Yeah.
I mean, a director's only behind the camera for maybe 3 months every 5 years, if he's lucky. So, yeah, they're, and it was hugely learning for all of us.
So now, where are we here?
We're up the top of the flats. And once again, we've got the little kid sister, the little motif. I probably stole that from Gregor's Girl before he even made it.
Yeah, so the idea of the knowing younger child explaining the world to the elder older sibling.
Yeah, she's good at capital. She knows every capital in the world and in which direction it is. So this is the kind of beacon, you know, of the city.
But this is a recurrent thing with you, isn't it? That the knowledge of children. And
Yeah, it was at that time, and I think I've just used it. I think maybe you just start to, you know, everyone's got their little tricks, everyone's got their routine. I think it's part of mine, you know.
But the idea here is that you're up on top of it, and you are. It's almost like lords of the city, isn't it? Or
absolutely,
kings of the city,
yeah,
you know?
Yeah. You can see the city all the way around. And this is this was the drying area of the whole block of flats. You know, you got there to dry your clothes.
Get the key for the watchman. We'll pass it on to the guy on the inside, the little guy. He'll go to the back gate and tap out the signal. Three taps. The van goes in, the gate comes down again, really quick. Ronnie will show you the stuff to take. Just the sinks, nothing else. What are you doing here, you mug?
Came to tell Simmy just like you've been saying. Hey, I've forgotten about it two taps, so it's a good job you remember.
It's good to have you with us. It's a big job. But it's simple, and that's the beauty of it. We're all going to be rich. Now, you finish with this row here.
So, this is?
This is, Gordon Sinclair.
Yep.
I'd forgotten that. I didn't know I'd given him any dialogue scenes at all. But this is where I discovered Gordy, obviously, along with Rob. Gordy's kind of... The physicality of his acting, you know, was... Even there, it's quite evident, you know, He's quite happy to be in that screen. There's no problem for him being there.
Yeah. Yeah. Well, and also it is all non-vocal. It's all just to do with, you know, shrugs and...
Uh-huh, yeah.
Which, as we saw in Gregory's Girl, actually a huge amount of Gregory's Girl, is just to do with... It's the way he stands and the way he holds his arms and, you know...
Can you buy me
me a cup of coffee.
That's what we're doing it for. We've no money just now.
Can you do a robbery without money, can you?
I'm in the gang. 2 minutes. No, 2 minutes and I'm losing my head.
Did you find it fun on set? Because it does seem to me that you have almost entirely good memories of this.
Yeah, it was fun. It was fun. Yeah, as I say, it was a very exciting time, you know, to have that resource, because it was like the biggest gift in the world, and we'd put it together ourselves. Like someone had said, look, go and make a feature film.
Yeah.
And the next, and come back in 3 weeks. So
where are we here now, Bill?
This is the den. This is the gang's den, and they're preparing for the robbery, and they've got the girls involved because. This is the little kind of absurdist nature of it. They need some people to dress up as cleaning ladies, so the girls in the gang are showing the boys how to play girls. And I didn't overthink that one.
And this is a set, or this is someone's house?
This is an old. This is that was part of the youth theatre. That was one of the upper buildings in the youth theatre.
Yeah.
Yeah, but it was in an old school, I think it was. So once again, we had a kind of base there. But all of this was just lying.
I mean,
around.
The camera keeps doing that thing of drifting out of, you know, of a domestic scene over to something like a collapsed wall or a broken down car. The whole thing is filmed amidst this landscape, which is sort of quasi apocalyptic.
Totally, and it wasn't emphatic at all. We didn't search out these things. You know, they were just there. That's an amplifier, an editing bench amplifier.
Yeah.
That we're using there.
We should talk briefly about some of the people that you didn't get money from. You had thought about... did you get money from Tunnocks in the end or not?
Tunnocks?
Or did you just get Tunnocks?
I think Tunnocks came through. I think they came through with maybe £45 or something. And we certainly got some Tunnocks biscuits from them.
Yeah. Now, Iron Brew, at one point, you thought about actually having the whole siege of the Iron Brew factory.
But they didn't put in a penny. Yeah, that's why at the end of the movie, when the gang are planning their next heist, that they're going to get a pipe into the
Iron Brew factory
and pump it up all the Iron Brew. So I wanted to get my own back at Iron Brew for that.
Oh, I'm a girl.
Did I need you? I'm a girl. You'll eat this, didn't you?
No.
Stole this from Some Like It Hot. Yeah, Jack Lemmon line.
Yeah, I'm a girl. So this is, again, this isn't dressed, this is a cafe somewhere locally?
Yeah.
Can you remember where?
Yes, we shot them all in the place called The Gushet, which isn't there anymore. It was an Italian cafe that sat at the intersection of two, kind of wide junction.
Yeah.
It was a very famous spot. I don't know whether you'll see it. They had this most eccentric portrait of Prince Charles on the wall. With Italian sideburns and a moustache, because it was an Italian cafe.
So pretty much everything is location. There's very little. So you referred to that thing when you said that's our office and we dressed the wall. But other than that, everything is pretty much location stuff.
Totally, yes. And think of the organisation. This is a cafe. We have to go in there. Paddy and the production people would go in there and ask if we can use it, pick a date. In this one, we had huge scaffolding outside because we wanted to light it. So this isn't natural light. We had to build a box around it and then light it from the outside. It was a full professional kind of gig. But the people did that. I mean, as I say, we get into the cafe, we shot 4 or 5 scenes in this place. And then the actual sink warehouse, the plumbing warehouse, we were there for a whole weekend. I call it the lost weekend because... we went in and the last shift came out on Friday night at 4 or 5 o'clock. We went in there and we came out like dazed rats on Monday morning at 8 when the workers were coming back in for the next week. We just spent the whole weekend there doing all the heist scenes.
And why did people give you those kind of permissions? I mean, what was the goodwill towards the project?
I don't know. Just people, I think the excitement of making films, people just forgotten that.
But that's like the thing in Local Hero when as the helicopter's going out and she waves to it and you realise that on the
But I think it was to do. I mean, it was an exciting thing. I mean, it was exciting enough for us to be making a film. I suppose it was equally exciting for a guy running a plumber's warehouse to have some people say, "Hey, we're making a movie. We'd like to use it, use your place, and it's local and all of that." So, I think it just kind of, you know, the feeling just went everywhere.
This is a Chaplin joke as well, though, isn't it? The shoe and the. Yes. I mean, that's it.
Yeah.
It just seems to me that there's a huge amount of grassroots support for it. That you know that it's
totally, totally was, yeah. And I haven't watched this for a while. There's a lot of kind of accomplishment in the way this is shot. I'm not meaning personally, but I mean just in the, you know, technically and in the camera work. There's lots of good solid things happening.
It's a really good looking film, and it's nice to see it presented properly as well, because we showed it. Last year in Shetland from the Blu-ray transfer, and it looked beautiful. I think you were kind of impressed by how good it looked.
It did. It's tremendous.
So this is cinema of awkwardness. You were talking about this as being a kind of recurrent Bill Forsyth trait.
Yes, it's just misunderstandings, people having to perform roles that they're unsure of, you know. Yeah, all of that awkwardness. This is the very early days of it. I mean, I think I kind of milked it a little bit more in other films.
But I think the extraordinary thing is just how much you can, the sort of the roots of all of your cinema are evident here. It's almost like you kind of emerged fully formed. This does look like a Bill Forsyth film. It doesn't look like somebody finding their way.
Well, you see, there was a tremendous head of speed here, because head of steam here, I mean, because, as I say, I'd already spent 2 years. We spent most of the 70s decade trying to work towards getting to make a film or get into that world. 2 years working on Gregory's Girl, the script and the, you know, this trying to set it up with the BFI. So all of that time, there was an awful lot of thought going on, a lot of excitement going on about the possibilities. So there was a real head of steam that was let off here. I mean, it wasn't. I hadn't realised just how much things were coming together at that time, but it's pretty solid.
And you talk about when you were shooting at the cafe scene, having the scaffolding outside and having light shining in order to give you artificial light. I mean, I had always imagined that you'd done it on a fairly stripped down.
You see, there's a little track there. Did you see that little
track?
Yeah.
Did you have a track, or was that a shopping trolley?
No, that was a proper track. We had a little track with the pram wheels on it. And that's just removing, you know, they're just moving it a little more privacy away from the lift. I don't know if you remember one of the receipts was for the guy who held the lift for us.
That's right, because you had to pay for the privilege of using the lift. You had to pay for the electricity for the lift.
Yeah, and I think we caused a fuse or something to go, because we wanted to hold the lift longer, you know, and some fuse went off, you know. Nobody catches this really, but the little kid here, he's actually practicing, because when the robbery comes, his job is to run up and down the stairs really fast with the keys. So this is him practicing the running up bit.
Oh, okay, fine. Yes, I hadn't noticed.
No, the sliding down bit is just to get back to the climbing bit.
Tuesday. And none of these kids had acted in films before.
None whatsoever. Well, there it is. There's Prince Charles.
There it is. Oh, yeah. That is Prince Charles.
The side parts, yeah. It's just the weirdest
that
thing.
That doesn't look like Prince Charles at all. And this is your love affair with phone boxes.
Yes, here we go. found one without a door. But yeah, that's just by the by, you know. It's not. There's nothing emphatic about it. He's picked up his call for him.
But if you were doing an analysis of the recurrent themes of Bill Forsyth, phone boxes right up until Local Hero do play a
That's
very
true,
significant
yeah.
part.
That's true, yeah. Really.
I mean, you know, Gregory's Girl, all that stuff happens in the phone box. Local Hero, obviously, the phone box became the iconic thing.
Well, they were a kind of focal point of public life, really, weren't they? They were part of the props of life, weren't they?
Yeah. So how old is this kid?
He would be about 12 there. I think maybe.
So is he the youngest member of the cast?
He is, yes. And he was he's an interesting guy. He actually came to the youth theatre at that age, and everyone said, oh, no, you're too young, you know, you're not a teenager and all that. But he kept coming back, and I wrote that thing in for him because he was around, but he was just a completely different age to the other guys. This is Eddie Burt. We got a loan of these fans from the roll company, Morton's yeah. Rolls, but they insisted that I have my actor, who was necessary, he'd drive it. They insisted that he be fully licensed with an HGV license. So it's a friend of mine who used to drive a truck for Marks and Spencer's.
So his key casting role was that he had an HGV license?
He had an HGV license, yeah. But that changed his life in a way. He got interested in the film business, and he became a top key grip.
He was
a wonderful dolly pusher. He spent the rest of his career in the film business down in Pinewood, you know, became a really, really top key grip.
Well, it was funny, you know, watching this, and then I've also been watching Gregory's Girl recently, is how many people in those films did go on to have careers, yeah. you know, good solid careers yeah. in the film, theatre and
Absolutely.
Television industry.
My daughter now is in the film business, and it's quite funny, every so often, she just came to me a couple of weeks ago and she says, oh, I was working with, you know, so-and-so, he says he was in that sinking feeling, you know, there's some producer she's working with, and there's a guy called Des, I'll show you Des, the fella she said she was working with. But he was one of her runners, but, you know, he was a producer. And this policeman, this was Danny Benson, who was in the youth theatre.
Yeah.
But he was also, at the time, he was a cadet policeman. He was actually a cadet policeman. So that's why I obviously gave him this part.
Because he had the uniform.
Well, the funny thing was, as that's the reason I gave him the part. And then he came to me and said, I can't use my real uniform. They won't let me.
Okay, because he can't use it for fictional purposes.
Yeah. So we had to go and find this old thing. But if you notice in the close-up scenes, that the cap on his badge is actually a milk bottle top. You'll see it in some of the close-up scenes. We kind of squashed up a milk bottle top and glued it on.
And again, all this stuff with, you know, rubble and go, this is just exactly as things were.
That was it, yeah, that's the way it was. And I remember wanting to drag this out just to the point beyond normalcy, you know, just keep it going.
But this is you in silent comedy and you and Keaton and,
yeah,
you
just take the joke beyond the joke, you know, and then see if it becomes a joke again.
But it's strange to see that Marlboro Country advert again, because now, obviously, no way you'd be allowed to have that. Mm. And this slightly jazz-funk score at this point.
That was Colin Tully. This was a handwritten score for the movie. Another friend who was in a band, a Glasgow band. So we had a lot, you know. We went into a proper studio in Glasgow and recorded this.
I take it instantly that no health and safety regulations are observed while shooting this. If he falls,
just
right?
Say, Rob, go out and stand on that pipe and don't fall off.
To see him in close-up to see whether we can see the milk bottle top.
Yeah, well, we probably went out of our way not to show you that.
Yeah, yeah, I'm sure, yeah.
I think it slipped in.
An automatic reaction that comes with the training. That's okay.
Obviously no stunt double here, this genuinely is the lead actor.
Yes. I think probably the art department probably checkered in that. They probably hand-painted that checkered thing around. You can see the milk bottle top.
Yeah, you're
top,
right, there we go. That is indeed PC milk bottle top.
Get it off straight away. That was, he was under instructions to get that off and that hat off in seconds.
Oh yeah, of course, so that's why he's taking the hat off, because otherwise you'll see that it's a milk bottle top.
You've grown a bit. You used to be a bit. I just sprouted the past year.
Who is he?
This is Danny Benson. He's probably, he's probably a chief constable somewhere by now.
You still playing a violin?
No.
You working yourself?
No.
Dude, this is very you, the idea, it's things in single takes. You don't do, you know, cutaways, and you don't. There's no extraneous business.
No.
And even later on, in fact, when you were able to, as I say that.
Well, we did a wee cutaway there, but not in their shot.
But that was a very sort of Brissonian cutaway, wasn't it? You know, the two kids and the, you know, that's your.
But we needed that. These kids were actually watching it, and I said to Mick to get a shot like that, because knowing that we were just doing this in the two shot, the chances of getting it one take were very slim, so we needed somewhere to go.
So those two kids were just, they weren't...
They were just sitting up there, yeah. They might have been travelling children, because there was a travellers' camp just up there.
Right. I think, you know. So wherever possible, you did just use whatever was there, whoever was there. I mean, you worked around the natural...
Well, it was there to be taken, yeah, if it had any meaning, if it had any potential, yeah.
This is my notebook. Beam!
My name is Ro.
No fixed a board.
Because we haven't even got to the heist yet.
No, I know. I know, you're 40 minutes and you're halfway through the running time and you haven't got there yet.
I know you're not a bad lad. Yep. Just mixing with the wrong crowd, that's all. Do yourself a favour.
But it's right, because I remember the script, when it was finished, it was 40 pages, so that should have equated to like 40 minutes. It's normally a page a minute. So, funnily enough, that's what I thought I was going to end up with, a film that was 40 minutes long. And all of this happened, you know, the extra minutes and things, they just happened all in the little things that, the little accretions, you know, the little events that happened to build it up. Fair enough, you know, we wrote a few more scenes, but it was just that idea that's always stuck with me as a filmmaker, and that is that whatever you've got in your script, you can always make it better on the day, you know, you can, just for the audience's sake, you should be looking to add things and make it more entertaining.
Well, I think the fascinating thing about watching this is that it's... You know, the thing that became, I know that you say that you don't have a distinctive style, but there, the traits of your filmmaking, it's the stuff between the dialogue, it's the pauses, and it's the, you know, and it's those, it's the gaps between what people say and the physical movies. As I say, I keep referring to silent comedy and physical comedy, and I think obviously later on your filmmaking developed in other ways, but you're very much rooted in those traditions of non-verbal physical.
Yes, I see what you mean. Yeah, it was very much a cinema of the time as well. I mean, the kind of films that I was watching in the 50s and 60s on TV mostly, it was the classic cinema of the 30s and 40s, because it was just recycled to us, you know, 20 years later.
There was more establishing rain there, which obviously you weren't short of at any point.
Puddles, yeah. This is Mick Coulter's flat for the breakfast scene.
So you just used the crew's...
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Seeing a snapshot, I could see my whole life flash before my eyes. It was horrible wrong. I can see it now.
Did you have to get permission to put the huge cornflakes packet in, or did you get any money from cornflakes for doing it?
I never thought
nowadays, of that. Nowadays, that would count as product placement.
I never thought of that. I don't know where the cornflakes came from, but... They were there, and they were there to go to the script because he's got. He was going to kill himself with cornflakes in an earlier scene.
That's right, yeah.
It probably was one of the kids that was just crazy about cornflakes, you know, in real life. And he just kind of used it. We shot so many scenes on this one. You can see the milk is slightly watery. We kept on to add water to the milk so it would last.
Because
he would gulp it every time he did that take.
And going through the receipts, you didn't have an infinite amount of milk, because every pint of milk, every cheese cracker was accounted for in those receipts, which you still have to this day.
We would just take the bottle under the sink and top it up.
So now we're sort of moving towards the meat of the action.
Yep. This is it. This is it.
But you're right, it is interesting, 45 minutes into the film and that hasn't started. I mean, I hadn't noticed that before, but you're right.
I think this is a film you call kind of hangdog film, isn't it? Is that what you call it? Kind of hangdog, where it just plods along at its own pace.
So now this is sort of setting up one of the oddest bits of the plot, which is that most of the plot is kind of fairly realistic, and you know the factory really is there, and you really could do this. But then there's this whole weird subplot about drugging him into a stupor.
Uh-huh.
Where did that come from?
Well, I don't know. It just seemed necessary, you know.
But it's almost like he's come out of a slightly different film.
I know. Well, as I say, the whole thing ends up really a fantasy in the mind of one or all of the kids.
And then once he's gone into that, he now basically stays.
He's in suspended animation
for the rest of the.
For the rest of the film, yeah, and.
So you've used his drive. You've used his HGV license, and now you've effectively written him out of the dialogue by just having him stupefied for the rest of the movie.
Well, he can act. You know, he wasn't an actor. So.
Well, he's doing a pretty good job of doing a stupefied exactly. man.
He spent the next week and a half just turning up from his work and going like that.
But it's almost like a science fiction element has crept into it, because there's something really strange about the way in which he's been stupefied. For that. What on earth were you thinking?
God knows. No, it's weird.
I mean, this really struck me when I, you know, watched it again just last year. I had forgotten just how big of a point it is that this is what happens to him, and he just stays like that.
And the old scientist here can't quite believe it either.
So is he now going to drive the van, and does he also have an HGV license?
I think we possibly cut away from this just before that happens, and then Eddie would wake up to drive
to drive the van.
And we're
and
learning.
Then the arm goes back up again.
But you see, we're learning all the time. Get his eyes closed, because you can't act with your eyes open. You can act forever.
Ah, yeah, there we go. So you cut away, so it's not him driving the van.
We're learning every trick in the book here.
So now it starts to turn it more into sort of screwball caper and...
Yeah, we've got the caper here, yeah.
And the idea for the heist, for the caper, where did that come from? Was that inspired by a news story or by...
I had heard some of the boys one night just talking about some things he'd heard other people doing. I'm not saying they were involved in it, but I remember there was this bowling club so this bowling club and stolen some silverware and things like that. So I knew that the idea of kind of larceny was in the air. So we thought this film up really very quickly, and then I thought, well, if it's a robbery, what could it be? And the plumbing warehouse was on the doorstep, yeah. So that's really where it... Well, this is outside my house.
That's your house?
I used to live in that little muse here, but this is in the lane. Do you know what happened? About 10, 15 years after, I moved out of this place, not long after this, but about 10, 15 years later, I went back with someone to show them it, because it's a nice old house. And I looked in the paving stones outside, the cobblestones, and there was a piece of black camera tape that was still on the ground.
From you?
It was the mark for that van to stop. Yeah. It's amazing.
And it was still on the ground
15 years later.
I don't make camera tape like that anymore.
Yeah. The other thing that happened was this night, they used my little flat as a rest place for the actors where we're doing all these night scenes. And I found out the next day they were using my front room as a dressing room as well. And all of these guys were hanging about there. And guess what? My little wine collection the next night was all gone. They'd asked my little box of wine, about 7 or 8 bottles. You've been saving up for Christmas.
That thing about the camera tape, I did a documentary about Straw Dogs 25, 30 years after it was done, and we went back up to the church tower where they shot the opening shot looking down on St Bury, and the piece of string that the cameraman had used to attach the camera is still tied to the side of the wall. So those remnants of filmmaking do stay a lot longer than
absolutely.
You.
Absolutely. Tape was just right in that light there. That little ray of light.
So your house was just a little bit further
in the black
down.
There, just the other side of the light. This is the same lane further up. We just used because we just shot in that lane as much as possible.
So you were literally shooting everywhere around, you know, locations that you either owned or knew or, you know, somebody was personally connected to.
Yeah. And also it makes sense, logical sense here in the night shoot. If you've got your lights up and whatever,
yeah,
shoot as much stuff as you can without having to move the lights.
Yeah.
So we just shuffled along the lane there a little bit.
Well, look at your hair. What a mess. I mean, do you want a scarf then? How's it been, man?
So this is the Some Like It Hot tribute.
Yes. That's the wee man.
Come on. You really are a sight. Let me do the talk. Don't throw yourself out.
And he's 12.
Yes. And
he's very good.
Oh, he's great. And the last I heard, he's a very, very successful electronics supplier, hi-fi equipment.
Okay,
he's
cool.
Got a supply outfit in Glasgow. He's a kind of hi-fi expert.
Do you stay in touch with the, you know, with the cast and things, or with the people that made the film?
A few of them are, you know, they've dispersed to all the parts, yeah. But people like Rab, and you know, I see him fairly often. He lives still in Stirling.
Why is he listening to a radio that appears to have come from the war?
God, no. It was my record collection. I sincerely hope somebody paid for these records.
Oh, what, you mean the musical clearance rights?
I'm sure we did.
Yes, I'm sure. I'm sure it was all cleared.
I'm sure it was taken care of. Or else that was a cover version for the films. Yeah. I think it was off a film library, actually.
I think you've covered yourself legally. Yep. Moving on.
Yeah.
You probably think we're a pair of silly girls, but is this Abernethy's factory? We're supposed to be cleaning the offices tonight, but we can't seem to find a place. Silly girls that we are.
Nah. You're a long way from Abernethy's, ladies. Bend that up your crack.
It's our first night, too. What will we do?
Oh, well, you just sit down here and you can have a nice cup of tea and you can phone the man and don't you worry your pretty little head about it anymore.
Do you remember shooting this scene?
Vaguely, very vaguely, but very good acting from Billy Greenlee's the redhead. Terrific acting. And of course the other guy gets jealous because he's getting all the attention.
Aye, it's right across the corridor, and take your time.
So where is this shot now?
This is shot in the youth theatre because we did all the kind of corridor shots at the youth theatre.
Okay, fine. So you're on home ground and...
We're on home ground here. But it was the strangest thing. I knew so little about this. I remember when we shot that one shot there, when he comes out of that room and goes in there.
Yeah.
And then I said to Mick, the cameraman, I said, right, we've got to go down the corridor and do the other shot. And he says, what are you talking about? I said, well, we need the other shot when he comes out the other door. He says, do you have any other shots of this door and this corridor? I said, oh yeah, uh-huh. He said, well, let's do them all at once. I said, sure. And he says, otherwise I've got to move all the lights and move them back. So I had to kind of riffle through the script and find out all the shots where we needed this corridor.
So you were literally learning about that sort of, but you didn't know that already from the documentary stuff?
No, it hadn't occurred to me, you know, at that moment. See, there he is going back down.
You would have gone off, reset, and then come back and done it again.
Yeah. But Mick wouldn't let me. Mick was a pro.
So it was like film school for you as much as for anybody else. It is you learning on the job.
It was a learning process, yeah. But I'd say it was a pretty quick learning process, you know. Because up until then, the only things I used to joke about when we made these documentaries, we actually were encouraging people to leave the shot because we would turn up at a harbour, something, you know, we went to film some fishing boats coming. And then some tourists would traipse into the shot, you know, and say, get out of the way. We're trying to make a film here. You mind hurrying up, you know? So, you know, I spent the first decade of my film career trying to not film people. You just film things. So this is
a big change. That's what the setup was for the... Yeah. For the
training
for the slide, yeah.
I would imagine very few people get that. But
I know. I confess, I hadn't connected those two things.
I didn't go out of my way to explain it.
But really, it didn't matter, because the whole thing about him just constantly going up and down the slide in that obsessive way, like a, you know, like a child, uh-huh, anyway, would sort of, uh-huh, just seems like a vignette.
And it also could be the other way around. Maybe they picked him because he was continually, yeah, doing that, so they knew he was a good runner-upper. Now he's up there to get the key, I think. I'm not quite sure. It all goes a little mystical here, a little kind of magical. It's like we're kind of in Aladdin's cave when you see all the toilets, all the ceramic shapes. Oh yeah, he's been told the key's in the pan, and there's lots of pans.
And that, presumably, that is the...
That's a plumber's warehouse.
That is, yeah, and that's just as it is.
That's it, yeah. And I see, we went in there at 5 on a Friday and come out at 7 on Monday morning.
Again, I mean, there is something strangely surreal about that row upon row upon row of toilets, yeah, and row upon row of, mm-hmm, sinks and that sort of thing. And you do like that sort of thing. You like the sort of strange unnaturalness of the ordinary.
Yeah, well, there's the sculptural nature of, yeah, it. Yeah, yeah.
And again, I mean, that can't have been the easiest thing to light. I mean, that looks like a, you know...
No, it was a very slow process, yeah. That's why we were in there all weekend. It took time. And there's quite a lot of choreography going on as well.
What the hell's going on in there? We're 10 minutes behind already.
Relax.
Relax? Maybe you'd like to give me a wee something to put me out for a couple of centuries. Hey, doctor.
And of course the punchline will be a weird science fiction punchline of how long he's been asleep for, so...
Yes, uh-huh. Mm-hmm.
Was that an after-the-fact thing, or was that always built into it?
No, that was always, yeah, that was always in the dialogue, yeah. That was always here. Yeah. That was always one of the payoffs, yeah.
Sorry, mate, hold up. Lots of pants.
And this is Graham's, this is a real warehouse. I remember that.
And this is where the great, you know, the actual unloading happens. And of course, at this point, what you're doing, whereas all the stuff up until now has been, it's, you know, it's character based, and it's, but now you actually get into that mechanics of, okay, this is the plot functioning and
this
doing
is
stuff, and
this is the Reefy kind of delineation of it. And this is where I knew Gordy was a good actor when he jumps out here. This was when I said to Mick Coulter, I said, I found Gordy. I found Gregory.
Found Gregory.
Hey, Andy, your sister will kill you if you get holding your tights.
Well, you did say it was a robbery, didn't you?
Ah, you better watch you don't go too fast. These tights are run resistant. You could break a leg.
Ha-ha.
Let's get back to looking. Steel sink's kitchen size. That's all we want. Alec, what floor are the sinks on?
The second floor.
Third floor. Come on.
And then again, this very exaggerated walking quietly, which again is, you know, it's silent cinema. It's, yes, you know, it's, it's sort of broad slapstick.
I think everybody was enjoying the kind of playful, the young people here. I think they were enjoying the playfulness of it.
So everything that's in this, in this sequence was all shot over one weekend.
Yeah, the last weekend. Yeah, this was all inside the factory or the warehouse.
Then that's as it was. All those sinks were just there anyway. And
the joke was there wasn't one single person from the factory there. There wasn't a, you know, they gave us the keys to the place. It was unbelievable.
So you mean you could actually have financed the film by taking all the sinks?
The film could have been an elaborate kind of disguise of the real heist.
So tell me what it was like when you first saw this play, because it played at the Edinburgh Film Festival, right? And that was where it all really kicked off.
Yeah, yeah. It was that same morning when Colin Young laughed at the credits.
Yeah.
It was kind of everything changed in pretty much in that day. Within 9 months, I was shooting Gregory's Girl with a budget.
But the irony of it was that you had the film played at the Edinburgh Festival. and you know, great acclaim, and was, you got distribution. But almost the same time, you got a note of foreclosure from your bank, or a thing saying, you know, you're £100 overdrawn,
that's right, yeah.
Mr. Forsyth.
Yeah,
so these two things were happening at the same time. I mean, you were absolutely poverty line as far as the bank was concerned, and yet you were signing these big movie deals.
It was simultaneous. Yeah, in fact, I did have. There was one copy of the Glasgow newspaper, the Evening Times, where I was on one of the front pages as, you know, local filmmaker makes good. And I was also in one of the back pages under the warrant sales, the sheriff sales for debts. They used to come around and sell your furniture.
It's in the same issue of the paper?
Same issue of the paper.
Wow. And once this had all been picked up, and once, you know, once the Gregory's Girl train had started to move, was that it? Were you then in a different world?
Pretty much, yeah. Pretty much, yeah. Absolutely, yeah. As I say, just before we made that sinking feeling, I had asked the BFI for £29,000 to make Gregory's Girl.
Yeah.
Just after that sinking feeling, Clive Parsons raised £200,000 to make Gregory's Girl. And that was it.
And that was as a result of Sinking Feeling's success?
Yeah, totally, yeah.
And who was it who first saw Sinking Feeling, who enabled Gregory's Girl to happen? And who were the key people?
Key people, Clive and Davina, Clive Parsons, they had just made to Breaking Glass.
Yeah, so Breaking Glass was out before Gregory's Girl.
They were completing it as we got to know each other. David was quite helpful. David Putnam was very helpful too, because I showed him this, you know, shortly after it was finished. He'd heard about it in Edinburgh, and I took the bus down to London. He said, come and show me it. So, like, I'd gotten the bus to London and showed him it one Saturday.
So you took the canisters of film down?
Yeah. I took it down in the night bus, slept overnight on the bus. And came back on the bus.
And what was his response? What did he think?
He liked it a lot, and we finally got together and made Local Hero a couple of years later. But I remember he took me for lunch at Fortnum and Mason's and things like that, and then we left. I left him there, and then I went back to the bus station to get the bus home.
So you did. There was a point which you literally had your foot in the two camps. One in the camp of having made Sinking Feeling on, you know, keeping receipts for 16p and 50p for bread rolls and £3 for meat and £1.60 for electricity. Yeah. And on the other hand, you know, wooing major film producers.
Totally. And I remember that day when I got the afternoon bus home. I got home in time to go to the kids were doing a show at the Cumber. Funnily enough, Cumberland Old Theatre. They were doing the youth theatre were doing a show there, and I went to see them. And I remember getting into the room when they were all there, and they said, "How did it go?" And I said, "We're through the wall." That's what I said to them. "We're through the wall." And that was it.
Can you remember what it felt like?
It felt like going through the wall.
Because you don't stop to pat yourself on the back very often, but I mean, that must have felt like a...
Well, I had enough nous to know the film business. I'd been in the film business for, you know, probably nearly 15 years by that point.
Yeah.
So I knew what it meant. I knew it wasn't like, you know, some stranger was coming and propositioning me in something. I knew exactly what had happened, you know. I knew precisely what had happened.
It's the thing of them enjoying it, which is very Wilder, is them getting into the role and then, you know, and then becoming the Jack Lemmon.
Now, this was their routine. I just put this in because I saw them doing that. That was totally their routine, two of them.
Who's the watchman?
Oh, he's okay. All's taken care of him.
Do you want a wee something? You put in his tea?
Oh, no thanks, Bob. You know, we can handle it.
That was me doing the cat there. I do all the cats on my phones.
Oh, that was your cat voice? Meow, meow. That's quite good.
Yes, I did it in Gregory's Girl.
Yes, that's right, when he calls out over the window, so that's your voice doing that as well.
Well, he did the yells, but I did the cat. I did the initial meow.
So that's one of your skills, is doing cat sounds?
Yeah. That's why I have a cat in every movie.
And it's always
so
you.
Get my fee.
So Hitchcock would have like his silhouette or something, but you'd have the Bill Forsyth thing. Whenever you hear somebody, it's a cat, it's you.
Yeah, it's performance, right?
No, I don't. I mean, I'm a boy. No, I know that.
that. It's just... You doing any jobs, any more robberies, anything like that?
I've not really thought about it, you know?
You know, we'd make a good team. You've got style.
Do you think so? I mean... Not too sure, yeah?
No, not at all.
Did you laugh when you were making it? I mean,
yeah, we did. We had a good time. Yeah, I'm just remembering that we did.
And he's still not going anywhere.
Hey, you have a read.
No, this is the funny thing. He drinks in Nottingham because he's playing like the dumb club, but even poison doesn't influence him.
You do have a great fondness for that, for the single long take with the extended gag and the business and the pause and the business and the pause.
I think so, because it's something kind of nice and it's something kind of building.
When you look at this, is there anything about it that you think didn't work or anything that you regret or anything that you think I could have done that better? Or
probably the story's a bit creaky, but then I think that's part of the whole point of it, really.
And part of the charm.
It's a shaggy,
as well.
Shaggy dog story. I'm quite glad that I didn't know enough to bring things out, because you could have made a lot more of, Ronnie's ineptness. You know, you could have played that up to the hilt and all that. It's nice that it's all just there to see rather than to be emphasised. I think, funnily enough, it was in these two, this film and Gregory's film, by the end of these two films, I had realised that I wasn't actually interested in being a kind of commercial filmmaker. I wasn't, in the sense of entertaining through what film does. I think I realised that quite early on. But it just seemed so much of a chore to work on these things, because to me they seem so obvious, these things, the tricks that cinema can do and the manipulations that it can put you through. It's more fun just to play around the edges of it than just to go for that.
So when you say you didn't want to be a commercial filmmaker, you mean you wanted to make films that didn't court public approval, or
the ones that didn't kind of patronise the audience in the sense of giving them what they wanted or thought they wanted or what they expected of a film, I suppose, really.
That's a word that you use that word quite a lot in terms of not patronising the audience. So what exactly do you mean by that?
Well, I just think that. Most films just really, they patronise them by giving them what they think they want, and God knows what the audience think they want. You know, that's the problem. There's so little challenge in it. You know, really, and there's so many areas where you can have fun with cinema. You know, if you slow it down and you know, look at it and play with it. But then it's only one side of cinema. I didn't grow up with a love of film or watching film or anything, so as I say, I came to it quite when I was pretty well grown up. So.
And you said that you don't go to the cinema very much now.
No, does anyone?
Yes, I think people still do, but I mean, there's an awful lot of home viewing. I mean, people are watching this at home,
right.
Obviously, but I mean, but have you fallen out of love with cinema? Because you're going to make another film.
Yeah. Uh huh. Mm-hmm. No, I haven't fallen out of love with cinema. I was never attached to the box office experience. You know, going to the mall to see what was on this week or this month.
Yeah,
never really got into that at all. Not even as a youngster.
Do you still have the same love of the process of filmmaking that you obviously had when you were doing this? I mean, it's lovely hearing you talk about this, because you are. There's been, you know, sections when you've just been smiling at it and laughing at it, like it's a great memory. Do you still have that love?
Well, it is. As I say, it's just an opportunity that we seized, and I'm quite pleased to watch it now and see that we were seizing a lot. We were making use of it. That, as I say, it was a tremendous gift. Although we kind of brought it about ourselves, you know, we were given this filmmaking machine to play with. It was...
Is that actually a cat noise, or was that you doing it?
That's a real cat
noise. That's a real cat noise, okay.
We had to take that cat, we took it to the vet school and they gave it an anaesthetic.
Oh, really?
That's where we got the cat noise from.
Okay, so that is an anaesthetised cat.
Yes, it is.
Can you remember when that's what police cars looked like?
I don't know what the place is coming to. They actually got a helicopter on Martin's roof and lifted the sinks away. The main boggles.
And see, now those seem like real people being interviewed.
Yeah, that was one of the actors' mother and sister.
That does look like you've actually gone out and just doorstep real.
Yeah. I just said to Puff, the red-headed guy with the glasses. I just said to him, because we were filming near his block of flats.
Yeah.
And I just said, your mum and sister come down and do this for us. And I remember that was the absolutely last thing we shot.
That shot of her doing that.
And I remember as we were filming, I think I got two takes out of it. And then as we were finishing the second take, I heard the film coming out, the camera.
And that was the end of your stop?
That was the end of the stop.
Wow.
And Mick Coulter said, that's it, well, that's it. No more, can't shoot anymore.
Steel sinks and our very own snoring zombie.
Good Scots, Martyrs. He's worth a lot more than your sinks. That's a scientific curiosity. I could get £200 for him up at the university.
Oh, why? What do you propose? We wheel him up to the front door and ask for the cashier? You're a maniac. You're a psychopath.
I'm not. I'm a scientist. That's suspended animation. What I've been trying for ages to do that.
So the suspended animation thing had always been integral to the... I mean, I'm sorry, but I don't remember how many times I see this, the thing about him going into suspended animation.
No.
He's always a weird widget.
Yeah, well, it was...
There's like a 50s, sci-fi B-movie thing going on in that whole bit.
Well, yeah, but it's also just... I was just trying to give all the characters a little kind of thing to themselves, skill, a little peculiarity, so he just fitted into that.
Yeah, when you've ended up making, some very big budget movies over the years, and made stuff in Hollywood, and I get the sense now that if the next film you're going to make, I think you'll make Closer to Home, or
we shoot in Scotland.
Do you have a memory of this of being like the kind of the ideal filmmaking experience, and other things as being
no. No, this was fraught as much as anything. I mean, it was. We did it, but it certainly was fraught, and like every film is, just in terms of the time. Because it's funny, you make a film, you have all this kind of logistical energy and input to bring about this situation where all the elements are there for a very limited period of time. Yeah. The actors, the location, the crew, and everything. And then suddenly everything's got to happen in that little period of time. And all the other things are only just leading to that. But in a funny way, it's an insignificant kind of period of time compared to all the effort that's gone into bringing it about.
Yeah.
And so that's always a point of tension, because it either happens then or it doesn't happen at all, And so that tension's always there.
How long did it take to edit it when it was shot?
Quite quickly, because it had been... quite tightly scripted, and we weren't overshooting anything.
Well, partly because you were going to run out of film.
Yeah, we were going to run out of film. So it was pretty well, we're assembling it, as we went along, and it was pretty quick. I don't remember the editing process being all that long.
Okay, so pretty soon after you'd finished shooting, the film was complete.
Yeah, I was an honorary graduate of the National Film School, so they let me go back there and do the dubbing, so we got that pretty well free.
Right.
And down one weekend and got the dubbing theatre there for a couple of days. And at that time, they were screening student films that weekend also in the next theatre for the London Festival.
Yeah.
So I went along to the guy there, the guy from the festival, and I said, oh, I've got a film next door and we're just dubbing about it, you're quite interested. He said, where are you from? I said, Scotland, Glasgow. She says, no, we're not, don't worry, I don't really have time to see it anyway, but that was it. That was kind of July. 4 or 5 weeks later, after the Edinburgh Festival show.
Yeah.
This guy was chasing me around the film theatre in Edinburgh to get the film.
Did you point out to him that he had been?
No, I was just delighted that he wanted it. So it was straight into the London Festival, you know, like a month later.
And the festival circuit did it, you know, no end of favours, didn't it? Because that was where it really kind of gained its...
Yeah, I had lots of fun. I remember going over to Rotterdam as well. It was the first festival I went to. It was so exciting, the Rotterdam Festival. It was very kind of my first experience of an overseas festival. To me, it was kind of nice and glamorous and high energy. And they put me up in a barge on the river, you know, when I met a lot of other filmmakers, a lot of American guys that I kept in touch with for quite a while, quite a lot of them.
Do you remember?
Mark Rappaport, do you remember Mark Rappaport? Yeah. Met him there. And a lot of the kind of slightly underground Americans there.
Do you remember the reviews for the film? And do the reviews stick with you or not? I mean, I know an awful lot of filmmakers say they don't read their reviews, but I ask you this as a critic, incidentally.
Oh, yes. Well, I did then, yes. I did read them then because I hadn't ever been exposed to a review before, so I just thought it was quite interesting to see what people said.
Did you stop at some point?
Yeah, you know, after two or three films, when you start to jade in the critics' eyes, you know, you stop reading them. The first reviews were really, really quite pleasurable, I must say. This is a real Ricky DeMarco in this gallery here, you know, the art entrepreneur from Edinburgh. This was the only guy that I couldn't dominate with the dialogue because I'd written this whole scene for Ricky to just turn up and say the words, but he wouldn't say them. He just said, "No, I'll do it. You know, I'll do it," and he did it better than.
So all of that is
lines.
Just improv, is him doing
totally
what
he would do, yeah, how he would go about buying a piece of work.
Well, good for him, for being
self-parodic
enough to do
it. Well, this is the thing, because the way I was kind of slightly sending him up, but I don't know whether he got it or not, but he did. He just gave this great, great performance.
Sorry, what's your name? Cash. Sorry, M. Cash.
RBS checkbook.
Well, Mr. Cash, here you are. M.
Cash. I stole that from some American movie as well, I think.
And there's the van again.
This is it. And this is Des driving the van. This is the now producer that my daughter said hi, hello, a few months ago when she was working with him. The next van when the second van arrived.
Yeah, yeah. Because there's a van mix-up.
Yeah. It was Des, the runner, that was... Oh.
And that music there is very... That's the old ragtime.
That's,
you know,
right.
Like, yeah, so...
But this was written. This was scripted music.
But those are the kind of moments when you're most obviously flagging up the sources of that
exactly.
comedy.
Exactly.
You know,
that's like a Woody Allen.
Yeah. Exactly.
Skit, isn't it?
And then the two vans, which aren't the same van.
No. That's Des.
What I like about it so much is how much you enjoy the capery slapstick gags.
Yeah.
You know, doors, people coming out of doors and going into other, you know, all that sort of stuff. You really enjoy that stuff. Because that whole setup for the van switcheroo thing is so flagged up and everything, but you enjoy the absurdity of it.
It's very hammy. It's all quite hammy. But...
That is a very Woody Allen sequence as well, ending with the fainting.
It was quite deliberate that with the music, yeah.
Three dozen large trifles, one dozen apple turnovers, three dozen ice donuts, no chocolate donuts, repeat, no chocolate donuts.
Uh, And this was a real idea, but this is Tom Mannion, that because he was a doctor, he had to be slightly older. So I went to the drama school in Glasgow and got one of their graduate students. So he's a professional actor, Tom. He's still working.
Break it and reach it on your back!
No, doctor.
There's the other one.
It's still the same. We've got the computer readout on his biorhythmic...
And the guy in the next bed, that when he talks, is Alec McKenzie, who was our lead Spark.
Oh, right, okay.
And he also played the drunk in the very first scene on the bench.
Yeah, okay.
When the kid's talking and he says, shut up. So he gave me two scenes.
So everybody is doing... I mean, multitasking is the order of the day.
Yeah.
If you're not doing anything, there's a role for you.
But Alec, of course, had to set up all the lights for this scene before he hopped into bed to do the dialogue.
This is probably a good time to point out, Bill, that you had a problem with the dialogue, which was that you made the film, you know, as it was, and then you discovered later on that you could only get a distribution deal if you redubbed some of it, because people complained they couldn't understand what the actors were saying.
Well, that was in America, yeah, because Sam Goldwyn picked it up after he picked up the Sam Goldwyn Jr., after he picked up Gregory's Girl, too. And it didn't distress me too much. I thought, well, America, yeah, well, it's tough enough for people in England or elsewhere in this country to understand that a heavy Glasgow accent, and these accents are, we were speaking kind of pretty well, you know, vernacular Glasgow, yeah. You know. So we went through the process. I didn't object to it because I knew that, you know, it was, you know, Americans were going to, you know, be able to access the film if they wanted. We didn't revoice it in American, we just revoiced it in clearer Scottish, you know.
Did you use the same cast?
No, we used a young professional cast. Yeah. It was actors in their early 20s, as far as I remember. But it was a slow process. It was like 2 weeks in the...
Oh, sure, because you must have dubbed almost everything.
Yeah, absolutely everything.
And for a long time, that version was the only version that was available. I mean, in the UK,
There was some screw-up because the sound master, the original, got somewhere and then someone brought out a DVD or something, and it had the American soundtrack on it, and it was silly. I think they took it off the shelves in 2 or 3 days, because the only people that would be interested in buying a film like this would be the people who knew about it and wanted it for what it was.
Yeah, no, exactly.
And so they would take this home and can go straight back and say, what is this?
Bloody miracle, eh?
I know, I've heard the water into wine, but sinks into donuts. Fantastic.
Well, wait a minute. If sinks turn into donuts, what happened to the driver?
It's not him.
What's great about it is how funny it still is. That, you know, I mean, I've seen it sort of 3 or 4 times just recently now because of the festival and everything, but it does still work. I mean, the comic pacing, the comic timing is still really good. And the performances are great. I mean, they are a really great bunch of kids, aren't they?
They are. They're terrific, yeah. And having watched the other one recently as well, Gregory's Girl, this has actually got a kind of even a more natural feel to it.
Yeah. We're getting towards the very end. Is there anything else that you want to say that I haven't asked you about, Bill?
No, I'd say it's pretty magic watching it again, and the kind of thrill of having access to that filmmaking machine is still there. It really is.
Well, I think it looks lovely, and I think it works really well as a comedy. But I just think I really like those characters, and I think that the cast are great. You were really blessed by having found them.
We shot the lights out in Glasgow that summer. We did. Once again, this wee tag, it's almost like the tagging Gregory's Girl and the girl. That's Migo, the guitarist, and he's actually realised his ambition. All the other ones are still, you know, in cloud cuckoo land, and he's gone out and sold his sinks and got his guitar, so there's a little progress made there.
No, it's great. I think it's a really great piece of work. And as I said, lovely to see it again, you know, in good nick. Yeah. I hope that there's a whole new sort of generation of people can find it, because it's, you know,
Well, I've got something to be grateful to the BFI for. They finally kind of wrestled this film into shape, and I'm very grateful to them.
Well, Bill, thanks very much. It was a real pleasure.
Thank you. Yeah, it was fun. Yeah, that was fun.